welcome Chief Operating Officer, VMware, Sanjay Poonen.
Hello, everybody. How are you doing? Great to see you all and the wonderful security professionals here at RSA and 30,000 people at this conference. I know coronavirus is on many of our minds, so our thoughts and prayers with everyone across the world that are wrestling with this, including in China. What we wanted to do, I love these 20-minute type keynotes because they're crisp. We really wanted to feature a practitioner. So you're going to see in a few minutes, we're going to bring up a wonderful security leader from Southwest Airlines. I just wanted to set the tone a little bit for what we see are some of the key things in the industry that I want to challenge all of us because we think this is a group and a team sport. We need an entire village to really kind of step up our game in security. As we know, sort of this notion of ransomware is on the rise. We just have to look at a number of headlines and the types of things that have happened as a result of breaches that result in physical money. And at some point in time, it's also going to affect more than just money as a combination of organized crime or nation states step up here. And we think this requires a new approach because there's a fantastic landscape of security vendors. You know, you just have to look at the show floor and this conference or Black Hat, 5,000 vendors. But honestly, if you went to a doctor and you asked her, how do you stay healthy? And she said, you've got to have 5,000 tablets. You just couldn't do that. So how do you do this in the healthcare industry? You basically focus on your diet, your proteins, your vegetables, your water, and you bake it in. So this requires, we think, a new approach that is intrinsic, not something that's bolted on, something that's siloed, or something that's very threat-centric, but something that's fundamentally more built in, more intrinsic, something that's a lot more unified, and something that's a lot more context-aware. That new approach is something that the industry needs to have. Now, all of you in the enterprise world, think about these three types of layers. Your cloud, private and public cloud, your applications, whether it's traditional apps or container or SaaS apps, and your device world. That's today the nice framework, and security has to be layered into this where increasingly across all of those, you pick the control points and you focus on intrinsic security there. So let's look at the control points in each of those layers. Now, the bottom layer in cloud, you typically have two or three very important control points. It all starts with network security, one of the biggest aspects of security. Security has a lot more intrinsic there. You can't build point tools for data centers and then load balancing and firewalls and SD-WAN. It has to be a lot more unified. The same thing with workload. Workload is a form of an endpoint, servers or containers. And then, of course, traditional endpoints now kind of play up to the device side of things. There's identity, which has to be in different forms there. And then finally, sort of cloud. These key areas then surround an enormous amount of telemetry that's collected. We think these five or six areas are the key control points that security has to be more and more naturally built into platforms as opposed to point tool, point tool, point tool. And I think that helps you. We would like to also make you aware of a cybersecurity report that we did some research on. It's available, and I'll talk more about it. You can download this or get this from our web. We found a couple of things from research we did over thousands of CISOs we surveyed. Number one, we're finding that behavior on the attacker side is becoming a lot more focused on evasive techniques. You would imagine that, but that's becoming very clear. And we're seeing a resurgence of ransomware. Now, from the defender side, there is a real call for IT teams, corporate IT teams, and security teams to work a lot more together as opposed to in different silos. So as we do this, we want you to be comfortable with knowing, listen, I'll talk a little bit at the end of this of sort of VMware's vision of what we're trying to get done, but it's my pleasure at this point in time to bring out two individuals. The first one just joined VMware recently. He was the former CEO of Carbon Black. He's now the head of our security business, Patrick Morley. And the real guest of this show, of our conversation, Carrie Mills, who's a security leader at an incredible brand, Southwest Airlines. Patrick and Carrie, come on stage. Carrie, thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
Patrick, here you go. Take it away.
Thank you very much.
All right. Well, good morning, everybody. I came to my first RSA conference in 2002. It was much smaller than it is now. I've never been on a keynote stage, so this is awesome, and it's great to be with you, Carrie. So we wanted to just talk about how a practitioner views the world right now, and so I thought maybe we'd just start with what Sanjay was just talking about on that security report, and I know we discussed that a little bit backstage, but any impressions from that security report?
Yeah, so I got a sneak preview of the security report before it was published, and really the Defender portion of the report really resonated with me. We are executing against consolidated IT management and security strategies. And during that, we need to learn how to break down the silos. Our infrastructure team and our security team always have competing priorities, but as these intrinsic security starts to be implemented across our platforms, we have to learn how to work better together. As Sanjay stated, security is a team sport. Some of the things that I do at Southwest Airlines to help foster positive relationships with the infrastructure team and the application teams where our security is taking place, it's just simple things. It's swinging by their office and saying hello. It's saying, hey, do you want to go grab a cup of coffee? Let's see what's going on. Learn about their families. So I've been trying to build positive relationships with my peers and also encourage my team members to go create those positive relationships with their peers. Since security is a team sport, we have security incidents. And when you have a large security incident that you have to deal with, the first people that you need on your team are those infrastructure teams and those application team members. And if you have a positive relationship with them, it's going to make it a lot less stressful when you are dealing with a security incident.
So one of the stats, I asked you this about backstage, one of the stats in the study that I was surprised it was so high was 77% of the respondents said, we actually don't, SecOps and IT ops actually don't engage that well, don't necessarily get along. I asked you about that. I thought your response was interesting.
Yeah, I wasn't surprised by the stat. We have conflicting priorities that we're trying to deal with. You know, the infrastructure team's trying to keep the network up and running, keep our servers running, and the security team's trying to chase after them and make sure everything they're implementing is secure. So it creates some friction between the teams. So the stat didn't surprise me at all. But that's also that's not a stat that I want to have at Southwest Airlines. I want to build those relationships and make sure it's positive because we're all working towards the same goal.
So Southwest Airlines obviously is a very recognizable brand. You are on the board of the Aviation ISAC.
Yes.
And I think it gives you a really good perspective on what's happening across certainly the aviation industry, but also across threats globally. So be interested just to understand what you're seeing right now, what you and your colleagues are seeing.
Yeah, so as an airline, we have pretty much two different cybersecurity focuses. We look at the IT side, our traditional data centers, servers, network appliances, and you know, provide the same security tools and principles that you guys are probably applying in your environments. But we also have the OT side of the house, our operating technologies, and that's where our aircraft comes in. I don't know if you know this, but probably starting 10 years ago or more recently, airplanes now have an IP address. And so we have a security perspective that we have to try to secure. So it's a little bit different of an environment than our traditional IT environment. So we have to look and see, you know, what works well on the IT side, how can we apply that to the OT side, and then learn how to fill in those gaps. And a very important part of the Aviation ISAC is the airlines are trying to partner together to fill those gaps, because we can all learn from each other, and all of us are in this together.
And is the airline industry considered critical infrastructure? I mean, many industries are increasingly regulated from a mandate standpoint. Are airlines also in that same bucket?
Yes, we are critical infrastructure. We're in the transportation sector, and that's where these ISACs really formed. During the Obama administration, the ISACs were mandated for all critical infrastructure sectors, and so we, about 5 years ago, started the Aviation ISAC. Some of the challenges that we're having or threats that we're seeing in our environment, on the IT side of the house, it's probably what everyone else is facing. We get a lot of phishing emails. You know, we have to try to educate our team members on how to protect themselves, how to not click on the links, but no matter how many times we tell them, someone's still gonna click, someone's still gonna enter their credentials. So we're hoping that, you know, we have our basic cybersecurity principles in place that can help protect our assets when people do click those links. And then really the challenge that we're seeing on the operating technology side of the house is just, you know, how do we address aircraft cybersecurity and the ecosystem around it. By nature, the aircraft is it was designed with security in mind. So we're more in a state where we have to trust that our manufacturers have secured the equipment that we get, and then, you know, how do we verify that, that all that cybersecurity is in place, similar to how we do on the IT side. So we're working through that as an industry right now.
The example you just gave, the responsibility you have with the IT side as well as the OT side, increasingly, that's certainly what I hear when I'm talking with CIOs and CISOs. It's a little bit reflective on some of what Sanjay was just talking about on the intrinsic security side. It'd be great to get your perspective on that, what resonates with you on that, how you think about that.
Yeah, I would say over the last couple years, we've been trying to practice intrinsic security. It's not what we called it, but we've been trying to look for ways to shrink our cybersecurity footprint. How can we leverage the platforms that maybe the networking team already has in place and their security tools within those platforms? And how do we get rid of some of the tools, the bolt-on cybersecurity technologies that we've implemented over the last, you know, 10 to 15 years? So really for us, the intrinsic security is all about simplification and finding the correct balance of when we can leverage a platform that has security built in or when we need to go buy that tool. One of the problems that we're starting to experience as we're looking at more of a platform is, you know, who's on first now? If you think about a firewall that has security built into it, you have the networking team that's so used to doing everything within that firewall that they could ever do, and now there's cybersecurity technologies within that firewall that they need to take care of, and that's not their expertise. So that's an issue that we're experiencing right now, is finding that right balance of what traditional infrastructure tasks need to be done by the infrastructure team, and then which pieces do we peel off and have the security team apply their expertise.
And of course, that relates back to the teamwork element and making sure that the teams are aligned, which as you drive across multiple teams, having tool sets that allow those teams to communicate together makes a lot of sense. So when you think about the program that you're running at Southwest, and again, we talked a little bit about this out back, this is a constant battle. It's anyone who's in this industry knows it's stressful. You have to work a lot of hours. It can be exciting in different ways. What's your perspective on running a great program? Some of the tenets of that?
Yeah, I think it gets back to building those relationships and maintaining a positive relationship, because when we're at our worst moments, we're gonna have to rely on the other teams to help us. But one thing that we've been really focusing on lately is visibility and knowing what's on our network, but not just knowing what's on our network, knowing what's on our network and what those assets do, where they live, what are their functions, who owns them. If I have a problem with it, who do I go talk to? So we're starting to bring that as visibility with context. And I think it's very important to have that context around your assets so you actually know what's in your network or even in your cloud environment. And then another thing that I focus on probably more recently than I have in the past is how critical the partnership with your vendor partners are. When we're not usually developing our own security tools, we're going and purchasing them. So if we have an issue in our environment, we have to heavily rely on outside parties. And just looking out to your vendor partners to help in those issues, if you have a good relationship with them, it's gonna go a long way. So some of the things I do to maintain those relationships is just to touch base often. Just see, you know, what's going on. Or if I'm at a conference, you know, making sure I make a point to go talk to those vendors and catch up with them. And it really goes a long way. And when we're doing RFPs and we're looking for new technologies implemented in our environment, we really look at the vendor's culture. Does their culture align to what we do? Can we maintain a positive relationship with them? So I think it's a very important piece of the RFP process outside of selecting a technology.
You've talked a lot about teamwork across the aisle with IT leaders in your organization as well as with vendors. What about up? What about with the executive team, with the board? How does that work at Southwest?
Yeah, that relationship to us is very, very important. We're lucky to have support from our top leaders and our board of directors. At our company, we actually meet with our board of directors every other month. So we are constantly in touch with them. They're asking questions of us, and we're doing our best to, you know, provide them factual based security answers so they know exactly what's going on in our environment. So transparency is key. Yeah.
And when I talk to CISOs about how often they meet with the board, that is a quick tell to me about how strategic they view security. If you're meeting every other month, Southwest takes it very seriously. Hey, maybe just to wrap up, obviously RSA, a lot of vendors here. Again, as a leader in security, as a practitioner, what would your ask be of us on the vendor side in order to make sure that we're doing the right things to support the industry?
Yeah, probably our main ask right now is just to help us get past the agent fatigue. We have all these agents that are running on all our boxes. It's complex to manage. And when we talk about, you know, IT security and OT security, some of those agents don't even work in our OT environment. And, you know, how can we better build in security when we build up systems and when we build these platforms? And I'd also say, think outside the box and be bold. I know at least at Southwest, we're open to new ideas and new ways of thinking. We're always looking forward, and we don't have to always do what we've done in the past. So I think the bolt-on technologies, to some degree, are holding us back because we can't do more strategic things because we have to maintain these products.
Well, great. Well, thank you so much for this morning, and thank you all. And I'll bring Sanjay back out onto the stage.
Thank you, Patrick.
All right, thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Carrie.
Thank you.
Thank you, Patrick.
All right,
appreciate it. Wasn't that great? Folks, just as I wrap up, I would say that's kind of the key thing. If you just look at the last piece of what Carrie said, it's incumbent on all of us vendors to remove a lot of that fatigue. And we believe the way in which you remove that fatigue is by making something a lot more intrinsic. Please stop by. VMware just acquired Carbon Black, so we haven't coordinated but we got double the presence. We have two different booths. You can go to either booth, and you'll be able to kind of get a little bit of thing. As I wrap up, listen, from the standpoint, just a 30-second commercial, what we're trying to get done at VMware, you probably are hearing much more about us in security. We have a $1 billion security business and over 30,000 customers. We're focused in three areas: networking, endpoint, and cloud. And collectively across those, we're really trying to do something with platforms that are built in. NSX is our platform in the networking side. Carbon Black and what we're doing with Workspace ONE and vSphere is built into those capabilities. So it's no longer siloed. You know, as many cases, it's going to be unified or agentless, and a lot more focused, especially in the area of cloud and something that context-centric. And our job, and again, we're going to be working with plenty of you, is to ensure that as we build these platforms, you get the best without having to stitch together lots and lots and hundreds and thousands of point tools. Thank you very much, and have a great conference. Bye-bye.